I'm David Horowitz. Can luggage really stand up to the pounding of a gorilla? We're going to challenge that claim on Fight Back.
Saturday night at 6:30 on Channel 4.
You're watching Channel 4.
Channel 4 presents Bowling with the Junior Champs, featuring some of Wisconsin's outstanding junior bowlers. Bowling with the Junior Champs comes to you each Saturday at this time from Red Carpet Celebrity Lanes in Milwaukee, where John Kern is the manager.
Good morning. Welcome once again to Red Carpet Celebrity Lanes. I'm Hank Stoddard, along with Pro Tour bowler Patty Ann, and today we're bringing you our final show of our first season of Bowling with the Junior Champs, our last three championship matches, and we're just confident we're going to see some great bowling because we've seen it all year, Patty.
I sure am, and I'm very upset that this is going to be the last of the matches we're going to see. I've really come to enjoy this, and I can't wait for next year to start.
Well, there'll be a qualifying coming up, and we'll tell you all about it, or you'll find out about it by checking with your proprietor for next season. But we're going to show you our bowlers on the show this morning. And starting on our left, in the boys' 13 to 15-year championship, it's Tom Strong, who's now 16. He's from Muskego. He'll be bowling against David Marlowe, who's a good friend of Tom's, and David's 15 from Milwaukee. That's for the boys' 13 to 15 championship. Girls' 16 to 18, Sue Witkowski from New Berlin, who's 17, goes up against Joan Sharonbrock, and Joan's 18. She's from Sheboygan. And in the boys' 16 to 18 championship final, it'll be Jeff Middlestead from Colgate. He'll be bowling against Dale Griffith from Milwaukee. And Dale isn't here right now, but he will be here when we get our third game underway. So as we've been saying, it's been a great season on Bowling with the Junior Champs, and we have some bowlers here this morning that have showed us on this show they have outstanding ability.
Definitely. We've seen Dave Marlowe, right, and Joan come up from bottom all the way to the top, and I'm sure they're all ready for this and geared up for these matches, so I'm sure we're going to see some great scores.
All right, we'll find out in game number one coming up after these messages.
M&M's chocolate candies. The rich milk chocolate melts in your mouth, not in your hand.
M&M's,
M&M's, make friends. Oh, I found some gold.
Let me see that.
It's gold, ain't it?
Rich gold.
Hey, hold it. This calls for something special.
Come on, buy me a new pair of lizard boots.
Strong's beard.
Howdy! Do they grow beer?
You know what I mean?
From one beer lover to another strong.
News 4 breaks the news from Washington that affects you here. When the director of the Milwaukee Public Museum goes to Washington about the budget cuts, News 4's Glenn Wilson has the story. When business leaders go to speak against the purchase of Schlitz by Stroh's, Glenn Wilson covers the story. And when a Wisconsin mother testifies about the hazards of DPT shots, only Glenn Wilson gets the story. When news is made in Washington that affects Wisconsin, Glenn Wilson makes it known on News 4.
Well, in our opening championship final this morning, the boys' 13 to 15 group, Tom Strong was our number one qualifier. He shot a 245 on the televised portion of the show. So we haven't seen him since then, but we saw a lot of David Marlowe. He did quite a job, Patty, in getting up the stepladder.
David had to bowl three matches to get up to this title match and started out very slowly with a 173 and proceeded to shoot 246 and 234 for 653 for a three-game set.
That's pretty good, especially with a 173 start. And here's the young man we're talking about, along with the young man he's going up against. But I think we're going to show you our foul line judge, first of all. And there she is. That's Carrie Deckert, and she's from Sheboygan South High School, where she's an 11th grader. And here's George Vales, our scorekeeper. He missed a show or two, I believe, because he was off in Vegas trying to win Caesar's Palace, unsuccessfully, I think. In any case, he's wearing his bowling shirt this morning, too. Here are our two bowlers. Tom Strong on the left from Muskego, and David Marlowe on the right from Milwaukee. And here they are. It's a one-game roll-off for their division, the 13-15 boys championship. And Tom with a 245, but David knocked that off for the high single with in the stepladder with a 246. Good form, both of them, huh?
Definitely. We ought to see some great bowling, but only in a one-game match, anything can happen. You don't have enough time to get things together. You're in trouble.
Well, here's Tom. That's the way you like to start.
He seems extremely loose. Now, David's had the more experience for having the three previous matches on TV.
Go LS. That's, I think, David's nickname. Didn't we find out a couple of weeks ago? He said he couldn't mention on TV or something.
He couldn't tell me what it stood for.
David Marlowe on the right lane. He's got one, too, on a crossover. They both turn the ball pretty well, Patty. Any differences, though, in their style?
No, they're both turning it very well. Thomas has more of a follow-through than Dave. Dave Moore uses his arm as his wrist, and you'll see Tom, he cranks it up, but he really comes through the ball straight.
We'll see the replay of the approach on, let's see, this is David. Well, while we were watching that, we went back live there to catch that strike, so he does have a double. But I can see what you mean. He's a little more of a cranker, you're saying, than Tom?
Right. He uses his elbow a little bit more. You'll see it bend more, where Tom turns it up, but you'll see him come straight through the shot.
All right. Here's Tom. He started with a strike, too, looking for a double on the right lane. And he's got it.
A lot of mix on that ball.
Well, we told you. We're not surprised anymore. Early weeks of the show, we kept getting surprised, I think, Patty, at how well the kids could bowl, but I think we're used to it now. Here's the approach on Tom.
Beautiful arm swing on him. See that? He really comes from behind it and comes through it, but see that arm follows through all the way up. That gives him a little bit more direction.
On a cross, maybe. Now he's got it all but the six.
Okay, well, when you're doing that, you need not to pull up at the foul line. That's what's causing him to go Brooklyn. He's yanking up with his body.
So a chance for David Marlowe to take a short lead. He has a double up there. No. He not only doesn't take the lead, he falls behind.
He's gone Brooklyn twice on this lane now. I don't know if it's hooking more, if he's just slowing up. Looks like he's throwing the ball a little bit slower on the right lane.
Tom and David, I think I said earlier, are pretty good friends. I think they bowl in a league together, a traveling league.
It's a very easy spare to chop. So
yes.
We caught that, didn't we?
Sure did. Well, it's an open for David, so Tom Strong in the lead here with a strike-strike spare. David's gone strike-strike open.
Watching the way the ball reacted on that spare, I believe the right lane is hooking more. That's why they're having problems on it.
Well, I'll tell you what. I've got to tell you that we had some bowling out here this morning on this pair prior to this match, and the bowlers who were out here may have ruined the lanes for life.
I don't think so.
We had a grudge match that we taped for Bowling with the Champs on Sunday mornings involving Dennis Wright, George Vail, Leo Pack, and myself. And Patty Ann was the commentator along with Jim Irwin. We had a lot of fun doing it.
It was exciting. I tell you what, I've never seen somebody pick up splits with two balls before. It was excellent.
That was the highlight of my morning.
Beautiful.
Oh, it was beautiful, but that six flew around the 10 for Tom Strong. Some of the crowd here, parents, friends, supporters. We got a big scoreboard back in the back row there. It says go somebody, but I can't read it because of the people in front.
Okay, Tom just went to a harder ball. You notice he changed balls, and it didn't quite come up for him.
So he made the decision to change and may have hurt him. Maybe he threw the new ball with the kind of delivery he wanted for the old ball.
Right. And it did not hook for him.
Oh, up right on the nose. Well, he got a break there. He's got the six pin, but he's been coming up high in that left wing.
He needs to settle down and just stay with the shot. That's what's causing him to pull the ball. You'll notice a lot of the pro bowlers, they'll change balls for their spare shots. It lets them go straighter at it.
Okay, here's David. And on a crossover, he gets one.
Okay, he's still having trouble on that right lane with it hooking too much.
But if you're going to have trouble, better to have quite a bit of trouble in just a little bit, huh? Because then the ball gets over to the other side and you can carry it sometimes.
You start getting into trouble when you start trying to adjust back to the pocket.
There's David's brother, Dean, who's the corner man. Looking for three in a row. Oh, almost. Look at that hat.
That's cute.
I thought that was a sign at first, and it turned out to be a hat.
We're still going to have to try to find out what LS means before this is over with.
We might get X-rated and not be able to come back next year, though. We've got to be careful.
Looks good. I think he was a little worried it was going to hook away from it.
Well, look at these kids. They're 15-year-olds, and each of them with two balls out there in the rack. There's Tom's corner. Let's see. That's his friend and coach, Carl Gutt. Oh, when he has hit the pocket, he's had that happen to him a couple times.
He is throwing a beautiful ball in the right lane. It should be carrying. David, on the other hand, he has not thrown a good ball on that lane yet and keeps carrying his strikes. Let's see if he adjusts for this 10-pin.
Oh, and it's killing him by missing the spare conversion. Which ball did he throw that time?
He threw the harder one. He changed to the blue-white dot, and it went in the gutter the first time, so I'm sure he made an adjustment and hooked away from it.
Well, you get disheartened when you bury a ball in the pocket and the six flies around the 10, but you've got to make those spares no matter what happens. Well, Larry buried one that time. They all went.
He stayed with that shot that time. He didn't yank up. And boy, he throws a powerful ball if he just stays with it.
David in the lead here.
Looks better. Beautiful ball.
Oh, I'll say. Sign goes up, Marshall Law. That's because he goes to Marshall High School, I believe. I think I remember that from the last time. If I got that right, let's see. I think Pulaski High School. Wrong again. No, wrong again, Hank. So I don't know what it stands for. Pulaski High School. He goes to Wisconsin Lutheran for Tom Strong. And look at that one. Well, David's on a roll again. We've seen this before.
Maybe on the beginning of the show, he sure came on hard like Marshall Holman. Maybe that has something to do with it.
Oh, you're right. He mentioned that Marshall was his idol. Okay, you got it. Yeah,
he has seemed to calm down a little bit since the beginning of the show.
Right. I recall that.
Oh,
that
beautiful
time.
Ball.
That time. You can't keep throwing in the pocket forever and keep leaving 10 pins. Eventually, they got to fall down.
Very impressed with the ball he throws.
Well, he's still in this match. What is it? 17 pins down with two frames to go. He's got a two-bagger up there. The problem is, so does his opponent, David Marlowe. So you see the score there, and potential for a couple of good games here. No, a washout. The ball did not finish for him.
We'll have to see what he does at the foul line. We'll see his whole body raise up before he delivers the ball. That's what's causing him to lose direction. And then we try to adjust for it, and we stay down, and we're in trouble. Ball never turned over.
No. Rolling straight when it got there.
Beautiful.
He picked up the spare. Keeps them alive. As long as you can keep getting them spare up, there's always a chance your opponent can make a mistake. But if David puts a strike in the pocket here now, that just about will do it.
Nope.
Yep.
Amazing.
On the crossover, he did it. So the LS hat goes back on, and that one there puts him very much in the driver's seat going into the last frame. And Tom Strong's going to look back on this match and remember those two missed 10 pins. You see him up there, the fourth and sixth frames. He threw perfect balls, left 10 pins, missed them both.
There's not much you can do, though, when your opponent's carrying as many Brooklyns as David is.
Well, if he'd done that in the first ball, it might have helped out Tom Strong. The second ball, I don't think it's going to be all that much help.
We saw left-hander Steve Cook beat Earl Anthony in Garden City, New York, and threw a lot of Brooklyns, and there's not much Earl can do about it.
Right, on the Pro Tour this year, yeah.
That's why one-game matches are so tough.
Molly covered it perfectly. So, let's see. What's he got, a 220 game?
If he strikes, he'll have 220.
Oh, yeah, he's got one more ball left. That's right. Well, he's doing better than Marshall Coleman, because Marshall's got himself into a terrible situation on TV. Can't seem to win on television.
Marshall has not won a title match in 9 tries now. It's really terrible. I'm sure it's got to be affecting him mentally.
Well, he finished with a perfect ball. And there's David Marlowe with 220, and the best that Tom Strong could do would be 201. So David Marlowe is charged up through the ranks to win the 13-15 boys championship.
Beautiful ball.
We see that so often. Once the game's out of reach, and I guess maybe you relax or something, and you go back to doing what you wanted to do all game.
You stop trying to fit the ball. You say, oh, well, it's over, and you just end up throwing it like you normally do, and everything's fine. You know, when you're on TV and it's a pressure situation, we all have a tendency to fit the ball into the pocket.
And, of course, David had his chance to get used to television again.
Phenomenal ball.
Amazing.
I'm very impressed with his ball.
We had Tom just that one game. David had a bad game, a relatively bad game, and these kids are shooting like they are, averaging over 200. 173 is a bad game for him, and he got away with it. You know, he might have lost in the first round of stepladder for the 173, but he got away with that one, and then he came back with 246, 234, and now today, 220. And Tom Strong finished with 200 on the nose, and somebody wearing the Tom Strong T-shirt up there could be happier, but hey, he bowled well. A couple of 10 pins hurt him. So our winner of the boys 13-15 is David Marlowe, and we'll be back with the girls 16-18 championship final in a few moments.
Hey, chocolate lovers. Look, Three Musketeers gives you more of what you buy chocolate for. 2 flat bars don't measure up to 1 Three Musketeers. Because under the rich chocolate of Three Musketeers is a center whipped up and up. The more it's whipped, the bigger it gets. Taste for yourselves, chocolate lovers.
All right.
Three Musketeers. Lots more of what you buy chocolate for. Three Musketeers.
Lil Pack, representing the red carpet lanes, our tournament director for this show, and it's been a great year on Bowling with the Junior Champs. And Leo, we mentioned a while ago in the show that we had a deal for mothers on Mother's Day. You got one for fathers next month on Father's Day?
Yes, we're offering all the dads the same type of a program. In other words, any of the sons and daughters that bring their dads to any red carpet bowling center on Father's Day and bowl with them, the fathers get to bowl free. So get dads out early and have a good time on Father's Day.
What about juniors who may have had their regular leagues finished now? You got summer leagues for them?
Yes, summer leagues will be starting right around the first week of July. So if you're interested in a short 8-week league, this is the league to get in to get programs for the fall.
You can get some free bowling, too. Not just juniors, but everybody.
Right. Anyone that joins any Red Carpet Bowling Center league will receive a free game of bowling for every league game that they bowl.
You started something a while ago called Adult Junior Leagues, where you mixed older people and youngsters. How's it been working out?
Oh, I think it's one of the better programs that we have. And right here at Red Carpet Celebrity Lanes, we have about 40 different teams where the moms and dads or the relations bowl with the youngsters. I think this is good for the community.
We don't want to really start thinking about fall already, but inevitably we're going to. When's the best time to sign up for a fall junior league?
Now is the best time because the junior league starts right after Labor Day. So get your entry in now at any Red Carpet Bowling Center.
All right, and you want to find out more about bowling, give Leo a call at
747-1300. Thank you, Hank.
All right, Leo. We have completed our boys' championship final. There's your winner, David Marlowe, 220 to 200 over Thomas Strong. Coming up next, the girls' 16 to 18 title final.
See, I'll work on the average of an 11-hour day, and when I'm beginning to get hungry, I'm not thinking about my work, I'm thinking about my next meal.
It's so satisfying.
Snickers is packed with peanuts. I'll have one at 2 or 3 in the afternoon when I'm hungry, and come dinner time, I'm fine.
Peanuts in peanut butter nougat, caramel, and milk chocolate.
Satisfying.
Packed with peanuts, Snickers really satisfies.
I'm not hungry. I know I'm going to be okay till dinner time.
It's a very delicious kind of day.
Strawberry shortcake's fixing breakfast. Smells good.
It's my new strawberry shortcake cereal. It's berry pink.
Strawberry pink.
With a crispy strawberry taste.
Even smells like strawberry.
My very favorite.
Most important.
I know. It's a very tasty part of this good nutritious breakfast.
You're pretty bright.
So are you.
New strawberry shortcake cereal.
It's very delicious.
Well, David, the winner in the boys 13 to 15 with that big 220 game, and now the girls 16 to 18, Sue Witkowski against Joan Scharenbrock. That's Sue on the left, Joan on the right, and Joan, of course, has come up the way David did through the stepladder, rolling games of 199, 191, and 183, but Sue rolled a 214 to be the top qualifier, so obviously she's capable, Patty.
Oh, she sure is. There's no problem about that. We've gotten used to seeing Joan once they bowl the three matches. We get pretty familiar with the bowlers.
And we'll have to look at Sue here. We haven't seen her for a while. She gets the ball out in the lane and...
Beautiful start. There's nothing you can do too much about that. That's a swishing seven pin.
I know you were impressed on previous shows in that stepladder final for the girls 16 to 18 by Joan's... form and style and delivery.
She has an ideal classic style. Whoever's been teaching her, I give them my highest compliments.
Okay, from working with Dennis Wright over the years, and now you, see, I learned things. I can't do it myself, but I learned things. Would you say that maybe, and we'll look at her next time, Sue's leg a little stiff at the line there?
Yes, sir, definitely. You're learning very well.
Only been on these bowling shows for 15 years or something, or 13 years. You got to learn something eventually. Well, there's Joan Scharenbrock. We'll see her approach.
The only problem Joan seems to have is that she has a tendency to force through the ball at the foul line a little bit. You'll see that little jerk, and that's what causes the ball to go high. She comes through it a little bit too hard.
I thought the little jerk was keeping score.
Yeah, no.
I couldn't resist that. There's, oh, I thought it was maybe going to be a spare conversion. But it's an open for Joan. You only get an open sometime during the match. Place to get his first frame, right?
Right, and then you jump on him.
Joan carefully places her feet. That push away and the delivery. Nice form. But the ball didn't finish for her.
No, she's a little bit tense right now. It looks like she's not real loose like she has been in the previous.
There's Mary Beineman, who's the corner person for Joan Scharenbrock. Dennis Wright down here this morning from our regular Bowling with the Champ show. He remembers her from being on Bowling with the Champ.
We'll see if we can get Joan settled down here a little bit.
Good spare. So she has her first mark, and here's Sue Witkowski.
It's so tough. If you start out bad in a one-game match, you don't have that many frames to make it up. You're absolutely right, Hank. Her knee is stiff at the foul line.
And she gets a washout. We saw this washout made in our last match by Tom Strong, I guess it was. And we'll see in replay what we're talking about.
She actually has a good arm. She comes through it, but that knee can't be too stiff. It causes you to start pulling and sailing the ball. You don't know why. You can't adjust for it.
She almost locks it at the line. We wouldn't suggest that right now she start making a change. She's trying to make a change like that in practice, right?
Definitely. Only in practice. That's the only way you can do it.
Okay. Corner person. I think that's her dad. Am I right there? Yep.
Yes, it is. Fred.
Okay.
No, when you're in a one-game match for all the marbles, you just bowl and try to get all the pins you can get.
Well, she got nine. I didn't know whether to say eight or nine there for a moment. Had a rocking, what was that, eight pin or nine pin? Nine pin, I guess.
That was a nine pin. Both girls need to loosen up a little bit. I think they're a little bit tense.
We'll see it again and see what happened to the, it's on a cross, the seven nines up there.
It almost just slid and stood up.
Finally, it went down, and she's got the spare. You missed our show last week. Our other champions in the girls 12 and under, Jill Albrecht of Wind Lake, who only bowled 226 and 236 on her two matches on the show. The boys 12 and under was won by Christian Helmer of Waukesha, and the girls 13 to 15 won by pretty Stacy Hansen from Greenfield.
Much better. There's that power ball we were looking for.
Yeah, we saw that when she was on the show before. And she's has now taken the lead.
The average for the age group, 13 to 15-year-old girls on TV, has been 173, which is very good.
That's for all of them. 16 to 18? How did the other age groups do?
Well, we had the girls' division, the 12 and under averaged 162, and the girls 16 to 18 averaged 182.
So that's this group here, 182. That's pretty darn good, 182.7, almost 183.
That is my compliments to the Milwaukee Junior Bowling instructors.
Yeah, and the girls 16 to 18, the high game so far was at number one qualifying, 214 by Sue.
Okay, she covered that no problem.
Stacy Hansen had the high single in the girls 13 to 15 with a 232, and that could have been a lot more. She got a tough break, a big split in the 10th when it wasn't really on the nose, as I recall that game. I thought she was going to knock off Tom Strong and David Marlowe's 240 games there.
She could have very easily.
On a cross, leaves the 6. Struggling to find a pocket a little bit here, Sue Witkowski.
Well, we see it all the time, and like when we only have 10 frames and that's it, we start to have trouble. We don't quite know what to do.
Well, you keep getting your spares. That helps keep you in the match at least. But Joan Scharenbrock here has a double going. Threatening to build up a big lead. Nice delivery, and no, she's got them all but one.
Yeah, she's yanking through the ball a little bit. She's helped trying to guide it to the pocket instead of letting the lane do the work.
Common tendency. Not just for the kids, but for the adults, and occasionally even for the pros, right?
A lot of times for the pros. We've seen a lot of pros shoot bad games on TV. As a matter of fact, I think it was 2 years ago, Earl this year came on and shot a tremendous game, and last year he got beat by 100 pins.
Yeah, shot a buck 46 or buck 47 in the finals of the Miller Open here in Milwaukee, but he wasn't going to let that happen this year. He came back this year and...
And if the great Earl Anthony can do it, anybody can do it.
A couple of big high 260 games. There you see the scoreboard, a 15-pin lead for Joan Scharenbrock. So the match got a long way to go. Here's our leader.
Looks good.
Kicked out that 4. Thank you. late action on the four pin.
Right, but that's when you got that kind of ball. You need that. You need that trip on the four.
And there it goes. And now a little trouble for Sue with that big split.
All right, Sue's just not quite rolling the ball good. If you notice the ball's thumping over the thumb, that may be squeezing a little bit, being a little bit nervous.
You hear it occasionally, that thump, 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 from some bowlers. And what some people do it on purpose, don't they? Look at this. Now, you hear people say they throw a full roller.
Right.
What does that mean?
A full roller is when, if you look at the track on your ball, it's in between the fingers and the thumb hole. A semi-roller or a three-quarter roller, your track is outside of the fingers and the thumb.
And a holy roller. Here we go with a strike attempt here. Let's get her that first strike. Yeah, am I right here? She hasn't had one yet. I'm right, Sue Witkowski. She obviously had a bundle when she rolled that 214 game. But it's not her day so far today. And the problem with this format, as you said, when you got one game, not much chance to recover.
Right, a lot of the pros don't like to finish in the number one spot. They feel like if they've had a game or two on the lanes, they have a better chance of winning all the money.
Well, she picked up that rather difficult spare. She's still alive, but frames are diminishing. She only has the 8th, 9th, and 10th, and Joan Sharon Brock is working on a strike again.
Nope, she pulled this ball.
But she'll take the result, right? But you can see that. We're sitting behind the bowlers, or directly behind the bowlers, and from our angle, we can see that she did indeed pull it. We'll see it. Now he picked it up after she'd thrown it, but you can see what happens when you pull it. Sometimes you go to the other side.
Right, but the ball's rolling. That's why it's carrying all 10 pins.
She's done it again, except for the 10 pin. Almost exactly what she did on the left lane, or on the right lane. She does on the left, but she leaves the 10 pin. She's in a position here now where she can almost just mark her way out. Really doesn't need strikes. She's got a healthy lead.
She has beautiful steps and a beautiful slide on her. That's where she gets all her power from, her leg.
Gets a spare. Well, if Sue Witkowski's going to pull off a miracle finish, she had better start now. 8th frame. Could use her first strike of the game. Come on, Sue. We want to see you get a strike or two here. No. She's never really found the pocket.
No, she's using a soft rubber ball, and I think the lanes are hooking a little bit too much. That thump over the thumb, we hear sometimes maybe she's trying to flatten it out a little bit to make it not hook as much.
Moves to the left side of the approach to go across lane to get her spare. There's the result. We've said many times on this show, a lot of evidence of good coaching that most of these kids have had.
You know, it's amazing. I go back home to Arlington Heights and tell them what a fabulous junior program they have. I can see why so many great bowlers have come out of the Milwaukee area.
Yeah, Milwaukee bowlers did pretty well on the ABC again this year. Hasn't ended as we're taping this show, but fellas like Rich Wonders and Daryl Meisel are up there leading the doubles.
Sue is down by 30 pins in the 8th frame.
And going for a spare. And has it. So she's still alive, but barely going when she comes up the bowl again in the 10th. Still in the 9th there is her opponent, Joan Sharon Brock, threatening to take the title back to Sheboygan. Eventually, if you keep pulling it, you're going to have that happen to you, right? You don't always get lucky and get over the far side.
Eventually, you will pay for your mistake.
She just did, and it could present an opening for Sue, because she'd probably need another open attempt. Of course, I'm not guaranteeing this open. We've seen some pretty good split conversions. No? All right, 173... 146, 56, 6, except she can't. Well, unless Jones starts throwing the ball in the gutter, it's virtually all over. Best that Sue could do would be 176, and as you can see, Joan Shambrock has 173 after 9.
That was a much better ball.
She rolled it, got it out there, and got some good mix, and finally carried the ball.
we finally see her smile. I think she's a little nervous about this whole thing here. She has a smile on her face right now. That's cute.
Well, going back to the Brooklyn, but she leaves a six-pin. Joan Sharonbrock in Sheboygan has won the girls' 16-18 championship with that 193 game. We'll be back for the boys' 16-18 championship match after this.
Mars introduces the California Sun.
Makes you feel sunny inside.
You can taste it in every Mars bar.
Makes you feel sunny inside.
You feel sunny inside because those big crunchy nuts in a Mars bar soak up California sunshine till they're bursting with flavor. Covered with golden caramel, nougat, rich milk chocolate.
So sunny inside.
Taste those crunchy California nuts. Mars bar.
Makes you feel sunny inside.
Hey kids, how would you like to have a set of Brewer baseball cards? All you have to do is ask the Milwaukee police officer in your neighborhood. He'll be distributing two cards each week, all summer long, to kids 14 and under. There are 30 cards in a set, and each features a color picture of a Brewer player or coach. Now, this one's my favorite. Now, how's that for class? It's easy to get them. Just ask your friendly Milwaukee police officer.
You're about to catch what baseball's best hitters so often miss on the television premiere of Sports Illustrated, as super slow motion photography reveals the barely visible phenomena of a major league pitch. Then, take television's first in-depth look at the U.S. women's volleyball team and their remarkable 7-year quest for an Olympic gold medal, plus an incisive report on college recruiting, all on Sports Illustrated. Don't miss it.
See Sports Illustrated Wednesday night at 7 on Channel 4.
He just called me up every day after school. I got $50 to $100 to spend. Let's go out and spend it.
What reason would he have to give you all these things?
I really don't know.
Why do you think he would do that?
I let him drive my truck once, so that's why.
Oh, come on.
No, I'm serious.
She just told me 2 days ago that she was going
to
come as a witness for him.
I did not talk to him today.
She did not.
But Eric asked me to lie for him.
Monday at 4:30 here on Channel 4.
Okay, here are two finalists in the girls 13 or 16 to 18, and you saw the winner there, Joan Sharonbrock over Sue Witkowski on the left, 193 to 161, and our final match of the year on Bowling with the Junior Champs, and it's up to Jeff Middlestead and Dale Griffith, and they are the two finalists in the boys 16 to 18. That's Jeff on the left. He was a top qualifier with 215, and you were just recalling, Patty, while a commercial was on, what a great match he had. And his corner person, naturally happy, that's Jim. His dad. Jeff can get it together. Well, he made it up to the pocket, but look what happened.
Bad break.
We'll see Jeff in replay.
Okay, Jeff really turns the ball up. That's our typical cranker, the power ball of today. Cupped wrist and just come through it.
He only does a little sideways hop there after he delivered that one. Yeah, he does it that time, too.
If you do it every time, it's okay, but that gets a little bit hard to do the same way every time.
You think that would consume a fair amount of energy, too, after a while.
Right, and what that's caused from is that his foot's a little bit out to the side when he's delivering the ball. That foot's got to be in front of you.
Yeah, also, got to be better be careful you hop to the side, not forward. Yeah, he does. Well, that one very well might have been a strike.
Well, he's made his adjustment pretty good. He's been in the pocket twice now, and we saw him in practice. He couldn't get up to the head pin.
Yeah, and all he's got to show for it is a pocket 7-10 split, and now a set, now just a 10 pin. He has it right on the nose. So he's gone spare, open, spare. And here's the young man in an early lead, Dale Griffith, with a pair of strikes.
I had an idea Dale was going to come on strong and be tough. After the last match we interviewed him, he just seems very loose and he's looking forward to bowling.
Well, he crossed that one over. He had 206 and 179 in the stepladder finals. semifinals, I guess we should call them, leading up to this final. You know, the boys 16 to 18, the average for all games rolled on the televised portion of the Junior Champ show. He knew that he had it open, was 178.7. Would you believe the boys 12 and under, the average was 178.4, so they weren't that far behind. And look at that score for the boys 13 to 15.
190. That is some bowling for these young guys.
Of course, David Marlowe and Tom Strong helped that out with those couple of big 240 games.
Okay, let's see if Dale can get it back together here.
Well, that has to be encouraging for his opponent to see. I mean, you know, if he started off with two strikes, Dale, and Jeff was, oh, there's Kurt Wilms, who's our alternate. Doesn't look like he's going to bowl here today because these fellows both look pretty healthy to me.
For a little while, it looked like he was going to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had a little problem with Dale. I think he got some mixed information on when he was supposed to be here, but that's why he didn't seem to start the show. But we had notified him and knew he was on his way, so he's making up for lost time now. He got a spare, and he's in the lead, but it's not going to be a very long lead if Jeff keeps marking.
Threw it out too far.
And left the dinner bucket.
He knew it.
There's his corner person. And let's see, that is Charles Eberhard. Friend. Big wide shoulders on that young man. Coach. Well, that one hurt, but had a chance there to pull within about six pins. And going into that frame, and he didn't do it. He's got 52 in the fourth, and Dale Griffith has 53 in the third. It's
Jeff's
a quiet.
Getting trouble.
Yeah, this is the quietest audience we've had, I think, all year.
I can't believe it. I think the whole audience is very tense today. However, that may be because we're not having that good of bowling today. The guys are a little bit tense.
Yeah, they start getting some strikes. We'll get some noise, I'm sure. Rip the rack, Dale. Dale Griffith fan club. All right.
See if we can Dale get back into the pocket here.
Yep.
Okay, if you notice in Dale, his foot at the foul line, it's turned out facing the 10-pin. For the right-handers, we always spoke about that their last step should be, the toe should be facing the 7-pin a little bit. It's just the opposite for the left-handers, and that keeps the hip square with the foul line.
So he's doing a good job there.
An excellent job.
Okay, let's see if he can make it a double.
Looks good. Oh.
Oh, now you've talked about that before, that kind of lead. What is that? That's the 6-8?
Right. That
is
the right-hander.
4-9?
4-9, exactly.
What causes it?
It's a bad break. You're hitting the head pin a little harder than you're hitting, for the left-handers, you're hitting the 2-pin. It's a super ball, and the ball's just finishing straight through.
Oh, he gave that a shot. But it's an open. And this match is going to be tightened up here if his opponent, Jeff Middlestead, can get it marked.
We always start kidding each other on the tour during match play. It's like, you take the match, no, I'll give it back to you, and it's back and forth.
Well, Jeff, with his first strike, and a good one. No breaks on that one. That was right in there.
He was a lot looser on that. If you notice, the ball rolled a lot better.
We're going to see a little jump eventually.
Steps are nice and short. You need to keep those steps under you. That's great. That little hop is that extra power he's trying to get.
What he'd like to get now is a double.
Looks good.
Oh, it could very well have been. And six just went right around the 10. He says, what can you do?
Well, he's trying. He hasn't given up at all. And like we said, you just bowl your game and you just keep plugging, and eventually you may just come out on top.
He fell behind about 20 pins, 18 in the first two frames, but he's hung in there, and he's very much in his match here in the seventh frame. And he's made most of his spares. He did miss one where he had that dinner bucket up there. He only got three of them.
He's making those 10 pins, and that's what's important. We saw Tom Strong miss two 10 pins and cost him a match.
And across, he leaves the two on the left side, the 4-7. Jeff goes to Sussex Hamilton High School, as I mentioned. This young man, Dale, to Pius 11.
We have a very close match right now. Dale has a 7-pin lead over Jeff.
Just reading the comments when Dale filled in his sheet, and he likes the idea of this show. We've got good reaction from the kids. They enjoy being on television, getting out here and showing you what they can do. Now, I thought the first two frames, practice, we watched them in practice, and in the first two frames, Dale really had things wired, but what happens there? How do you lose it?
Well, when we're practicing, we're throwing ball after ball after ball, and we can get loose and get lined in, but when you have to sit down and wait frames and get back up, it's very easy to lose your concentration or lose your timing because you're pausing in between. We've talked about that all the time. We'll talk about gymnasts, how they do the routine so perfectly, but if you made them sit down and get up and sit down and get up, they may not do things so well.
Well, Jeff was hoping maybe he could carry a high one there. But that 10-pin won't go down for him, whether he's in the pocket or high, it appears. Tell you what, his sister could bring home a sample from work, and it would be a delightful present for either one of us. His sister works for Excalibur Automobiles. How would you like one of those?
I'd love it.
Hang on. Oh. He watched that all the way. So did we. It just hung on that outside board, didn't it?
He let up on it, and it just held. It held that outside board is right.
Now let's watch it again.
If you notice, he slowed the ball up because he knew he threw it out too far, and it just hung on the outside.
Doing a balancing act. He stopped to watch it himself on the replay there.
Looks good. Finish. Oh.
Boy, that 10-pin's been his nemesis this morning. He's had every kind of 10-pin. A high 10-pin, a couple of ringing 10-pins in the pocket, and now a 10-pin that was a little light.
He keeps picking them up. That's the main thing. That's what you need to do.
You see the score. Very close. 5-pin different. We're in the ninth frame. Boys championship final. I'm bowling with the junior champs, 16 to 18 age group. Anybody's match.
There's a good lesson to be learned here for all junior bowlers. If you think you've been tapped, just don't get mad and try to throw the ball. It ends up goofing your game up for the rest of the time. Jeff just, he's upset about it, but he just keeps picking them up and hoping they'll start falling down.
Oh, look at this. Well, I saw that pin coming over, and I wonder what it was going to do. It knocked down one of the two. So it keeps him in that 5-pin lead. He'll go into the 10th frame that way, I would think. I shouldn't say that too soon. Yeah, he makes the spare. Well, we're down to the last frame. We've had this happen so many times on the show this year where the last frame determines the winner. The obvious thing that Dale wants to do is get up there and get a strike. Better yet, get two of them. No.
Just good ball. He needed that. He wanted it.
Well, he's looking over at that scoreboard. If he brings this in, he would force his opponent to... Well, he needs a mark anyway. Oh, he missed the spare. He missed a 6-pin spare, and he has opened the gate wide open for Jeff Middlestead.
He's pretty dejected right now.
So? He's appalling now, Jeff, and what am I? And he's got a washout, and that's very tough. Did he? He looked like he was going back to try to fit it again. He was right back where he was early in the match. Do you think he tried to keep it too loose, maybe to avoid a split or something?
It may have been. Yes, with the type of ball he throws, he's better off being light, but not that light.
Still got to get to the pocket. Well, he can still win it, but he needs to make this spare. Tom Strong can come down and give him some advice. He made it earlier today. All rides on this ball.
Could be. Oh, beautiful.
Great conversion by Jeff Mittelstedt. He needed to make that or he loses the match, and that one almost certainly has won it for him.
We
he has
still
to
have
get
a possibility
seven.
Of a tie here.
Wow, what's he need? The 7-8 to win. 7 to tie. Okay.
What a clutch shot, but we saw him do it against Tate Mariscal.
He did not throw that shot that he did with his first ball again, or he loses by one. Here it is. This
stay
is determines it. He's won it. Jeff Mittelstedt coming from behind in a 10th frame when his opponent, Dale Griffith, missed a six-pin conversion, has won the boys' 16-18 championship. We'll be back to talk with the bowlers and give them some trophies right after this.
Starburst, fruit juice, a burst of refreshing fruit flavor for you. Tastes like a mouth-watering orange, strawberry too. Luscious lemon and tangy cherry, you get refreshed the moment that you bite into a Starburst fruit juice. A burst of refreshing fruit flavor for you.
Naturally and artificially flavored.
Look, I salvaged this caviar. We got these T-bones, we can light a little fire. You're never going to find us. And I got a case of Stroh's.
Stroh's?
Still cold.
We got Stroh's?
Would I let you down?
Hey! Look. Hey! 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 Don't pay any attention to him. Maybe they'll go away.
From one beer lover to another Stroh's.
Sportsman, here's a new kind of fishing boat, the Sea Eagle 8. The Sea Eagle 8 changed my mind about inflatables. Yes, inflatables. They're no longer dime store toys, not the Sea Eagle 8 I use. It's so strong it bounces off rocks, so durable it lasts years, and so stable you can fish standing up. The secret? It's thick PVC hull and strong wooden floorboards. And look, unlike wobbly rafts, Sea Eagle's stable, perfect for casting, and gets me to lakes you can't reach with a big rig. Why? Because my Sea Eagle 8 packs in this bag. I can take it anywhere. But more amazing still is the price. Compare Sea Eagle with $600, $800, and even $1,000 inflatables. You'll be amazed, because at just $220, Sea Eagle's an incredible value.
Big savings, free trial on Sea Eagle and Menominee Falls. Call 251-9521. That's Sea Eagle and Menominee Falls. Call 251-9521.
Well, it went down to the 10th frame, and Jeff Mittelstedt pulling it out. Dale had a little problem there in the 10th. So finally, a top-seeded bowler won here this morning. Leo Pack's got some trophy presentations. Leo?
Well, first here we have the alternates that came around for all the competition we had here. And if, at this time, we could have Scott Stenerson all the way from Ripon came in here, and he ended up in sixth place. Scott, congratulations.
Okay. Thanks for coming down, Scott. Next, we got
Lynn Gildner. Lynn from Homestead. I want to thank you. That's in the girls 16 through 18. Congratulations.
Congratulations, Lynn.
Thank you.
Okay, now we get around to the big stuff.
And we have Tom Strong. Tom Strong was the runner-up. Second place. All right, Tom. Congratulations.
And Patty's going to talk with Tom.
Well, you bowled super. Tell us what happened with those 10 pins there.
First one I dumped, and the second one I just kept thinking about that, and I pulled it.
Right. Did it upset you at all that David was carrying so many Brooklyn strikes?
No, he bowled well enough. at least I didn't, you know, throw a 150 game or something. Okay. He beat me.
Super. Well, you bowled super, and we're glad to see you, and I'm sure you'll be in tough competition next year.
And the winner, Leo.
And the winner, David Marlowe, 220. All right, David.
Come on up here, David. Here he comes. The big LS sign is up there.
Congratulations.
David, you had that one game, the 173. After that, you were dynamite. You might have to take these pair home with you.
Yeah, I practice here enough, so I should be bowling. I should be able to get on them.
Tom missed those couple of 10 pins. That was a difference.
Yeah, it surprised me. He's usually pretty good in the spares, and I got those crossover strikes, which helped me a lot. And I got lucky, not little, so I guess that's about it.
Well, our congratulations on winning the championship.
Right, thanks very much.
Okay. And next, Leo.
And runner-up, Sue Witkowski, second place. Sue.
Okay, Sue was second place in the girls, 16 to 18.
Congratulations, Sue.
I had to ask you, you look like you just came from someplace in the sun. Where were you at?
Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
Well, you bowled super. You look like you had a little trouble getting started today. What seemed to be the problem?
Well, I guess I hadn't practiced in a long time, and just can't expect to win if you don't practice.
That's a true story in the game of bowling. Well, you bowled super anyway, and it's a great accomplishment to come in second. We hope to see you again next year.
Thank you. I will be here. Okay.
And the winner.
And Joan Sharonbrock.
Okay, come on up here, Joan. She wins the girls 16 to 18.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Joan. You have to be happy, 193.
Yeah, I am. Oh, my God.
Look what's happening here. That's your aunt. Turn around so they can see on camera there.
I didn't want me to give her these, because she's in the hospital today. Oh, your corner girl, Mary Vitamin.
Oh, okay, well, there's a surprise for you. A couple of roses, and wish your mother well. We hope she comes along well.
She will. She's having a foot operation.
All right, congratulations. Hope to see you back next year.
I can't. Too old.
Too old. Well, all right, we'll see you in the regular show. Okay. And the boys, 16 to 18.
And the boys, second place, Jeff... Nope, wrong here.
Dale Griffith.
Dale Griffith. All right, from Pius. There we go.
Dale, you bowled super the whole tournament. We watched in practice. You were striking a bunch and started out with two strikes. What happened?
The alleys were different. It was hot here. My hand pump was going up a lot, and they broke down real fast.
What ran through your mind when you ran through that 6-pin in the 10th frame?
Like, oh, my God.
Did you know you needed it to clutch up the match?
To make it tight. In the fourth and the double, I do that if I struck. I needed the spare to make them double.
Okay, and did that put a little extra added pressure on you?
Yeah, it was a little pressure. And then I stuck another goal, but I knew I missed it right away.
Well, you bowled super anyway, and you gave us an exciting match, and we hope to see you again next year.
Thank you.
Okay, and here's our champion in the boys 16 to 18. Leo?
Dale Griffith from I got it. Jeff Middlestad. Okay.
Jeff Middlestad. Jeff, we want to congratulate you. That was a big, big shot in the 10th frame. You knew you needed it to win, didn't you?
Yeah, I know I had to make the washout and get at least 8 pins to win it. I was a little surprised with the scores, but it was exciting anyway.
You seemed to not have it for a while as far as your strike, and then you got it together.
I don't think I only had one, maybe two strikes the whole match, but I threw the ball in the pocket and I left some 10 pins, but Dale kept putting pressure on me, so it was down to the wire. It was a good match.
We congratulate you on winning the championship. Good luck when you go down to UW Parkside this fall.
Thank you.
Okay. And Patty, we're way out of time here, but I just want to tell you what a pleasure it's been working with you on this show and bowling with the junior champs. Was it enjoyable for you, too?
Definitely. You make things very easy, and I was very impressed with all the bowling, and I hope to be back again next year.
All right. We hope to see you next year. Watch through the summer for the reruns of Bowling with the Junior Champs. Good afternoon, everybody.
I'm David Horowitz. Can luggage really stand up to the pounding of a gorilla? We're going to challenge that claim on Fight Back.
Saturday night at...